appreciate you guys worshiping tonight. I appreciate you guys being patient with me.
But I tell you, it sure is a treat to get to stand before you and play guitar and sing songs to our Savior together.
Woo!
It's wonderful. And
you guys, can we pray?
And we'll dive into a pretty cool night tonight.
Father, I thank you. Father, we thank you for you being you and for your name to be above all. We thank you, Lord, that you're the Savior of the world, and you see through all the mud and the muck of our lives to our hearts. And Lord, you love us because you see who you created us to be, not who the world sees that we are. And Father, I pray tonight that we measure ourselves up against you. And Lord, that we look at the plumb line in which you've established here on this earth as we are inviting your kingdom here, following the example of Jesus. I pray, Lord, that tonight that we enjoy the time together as we get to the crux of the matter, as we get to the heart and soul of Jesus' message, that everything hinges on these words, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. And so, Father, I pray tonight that you help us to look deep down inside, to check out, take inventory of our lives. And Lord, as we do that, Lord, let us not measure ourselves according to the standards in which the world we live in measures us by. But Father, may we measure ourselves by your standard. And Father, may we see our lives the way you see our lives. And Lord, not as horrible and awful. But Lord, you long for more time with us. You long for more of our enjoyment of you. You long for us to see where you are blessing over and above. And Lord, I pray that you help us to bask in your presence. And so, Father, as we've asked to meet with you tonight, we've asked you to draw us close. Lord, we ask that tonight we are able to sing praises to you and we are able to live life from the inside out. And Lord, I pray that you be with us as we try this, as we surrender our lives to you together. We pray this in the name of Jesus. Amen. You guys remember, I've told stories several times of folks that were kind of like the folks that I was in college with, that, you know, where I went to school, it was very expected that people were going to live a life that somewhat reflects the Savior of the world. And so some folks got really smart with this and could learn how to deceive people and look a certain way. And so what they would do is they would sleep in on Sunday mornings, and then they would enjoy some time getting ready in the morning. And then after they got ready, then they'd go to lunch, and that way it appeared as if they'd been in church that day. And you've heard me tell that story. You also may remember a story that I told, man, it's probably been 2 years now, of a lady that I was talking with. And as we were talking, she was telling me, it was around Thanksgiving, and she was telling me that she had gone to serve the homeless at a soup kitchen, and she was just took her whole family there and really enjoyed the time there. And it just was very meaningful to her to be able to be there and be able to serve food to them. But as our conversation kept going, it became glaringly obvious that she had been at the soup kitchen in order to serve food to the homeless so that she could tell me that she had served food to the homeless. And so there was this expectation of human kudos for the action that had been taking place. And you guys, there's tons and tons of stories. You guys know a lot of folks like this as well. And have you guys ever seen somebody, like maybe it's in Austin, or maybe you've been in D.C. or New York or somewhere like that, that's got a bullhorn, they're standing on a street corner, and they're yelling out phrases to people about Jesus? You ever heard people like that before? They're the nicest people you've ever met, aren't they? No. I mean, they reflect Jesus, a spitting image of Jesus, don't they? No. I mean, they're sitting here saying, you know, Jesus is the Savior of the world, and at the same time they're saying, you're going to go to hell if you don't accept Jesus right now, and the world's going to come to an end, and it's this horrible, horrible thing, and they're supposed to be proclaiming and saying they love Jesus and the person of Jesus, who is the reflection of the definition of God being love, and the words that are coming out of their mouth are anything but loving. Anything but forgiving, anything but graceful. We have a word for all of these examples that I'm giving here, don't we? It's a really pretty word, one that none of us want ever to be called out against us, but the word is hypocrite.
It's, they're saying one thing on the outside, but they're saying a completely different thing on the inside. And whatever words are coming out of their mouth are not who they are.
And so tonight we get the privilege of the key truth in Jesus' message being that our righteous actions are not so righteous when they're done to impress others.
And so it doesn't matter how good we are, it doesn't matter how much good stuff we do, if our good actions are not so, our good actions, they're not so righteous whenever our motivation to do them is just to please other people, or to impress other people, or to get human accolades, or human praise.
And so today we invite thy kingdom come and thy will be done here on earth as it is in heaven at another level. We take it to another level. And tonight's going to, it's a little bit of a challenge, maybe a lot of a challenge inside of us, because there's a very real thing that is at war for our hearts.
And it's a very real, tangible moment where we know we are to be selfless, but we also know that we have needs that need to be met all at the same time.
And so here's what it all boils down to. Jesus is telling this message. You guys know we're in Matthew chapter 5. Tonight we'll be moving into chapter 6. But this is his Sermon on the Mount. This is the first message that Jesus is proclaiming in his public ministry. And he's highly concerned that the people, especially the churchgoers of the time, the religious people, he was very concerned that they wanted others to see them give to the needy or to pray in public so that they would be noticed for the good things that they're doing. Jesus was concerned that they were pretending to pray with a sincere heart, but truthfully, they were more concerned with what others thought of them than what God thinks of them.
And Jesus is clearing up here in just a few moments. He's going to clear up that when this happens, we lose our reward with God, because our reward in that moment becomes an earthly reward. It becomes an instantaneous earthly reward for wanting praise from people. But here's the thing is, we've got this big problem now. Because if you guys will remember a couple of weeks ago, you remember these words from Jesus. He says, "Let your light shine before others, that they may see your good deeds and glorify your Father in heaven." And now in his next point, Jesus is saying, be careful not to practice your righteousness in front of others to be seen by them. If you do, you will have no reward from your Father in heaven.
Well, what the heck is going on? Is Jesus talking out of both sides of his mouth here? I mean, he's saying one thing, and it sure as heck sounds like he's contradicting himself just a chapter later, doesn't it?
Well, the reality is, no, Jesus is not contradicting himself. What he's actually doing is he's pointing out the importance of why we do what we do. And what is the motivation for why we're doing what we do on a regular basis? What's the motivation for the good? What's the motivation for the bad? What's the motivation for all things that make up our lives? It's important that people see God at work in our lives. There's no doubt. It's very important that people see God at work. But we've got to always check our motives behind the good things that we are doing as commanded by God.
We're to let our light shine bright before men. We're to let that light shine bright so that God may be glorified. But the danger is, my guess is you felt this. I know I have felt this. The danger is, in letting our light shine bright so that God may be glorified, we may find ourselves wanting to be glorified as well. We may find ourselves wanting people to notice that we're good. We may find ourselves wanting people to see that, man, way to go. I don't know that I can live the life that you live. Excellent job. Wow. And they're saying these things, and the hard part is that when we find ourselves wanting to be glorified at the same time, it makes us that nasty word that we said earlier that we don't like. It makes us a hypocrite. And so we've got to talk about this tonight. Maybe hypocrisy, this is the thing that is like the bane in the existence of all religions on the face of the planet. And we know as Christians, it's the number one thing that turns people away from the church. The number one thing is that people that attend church on a Sunday, they say they love Jesus, and throughout the week, they live a life that is anything but a reflection of Jesus. And they see a two-face in this. They see them being one way on Monday, another way on Sunday. They see you being one way on Saturday night. They see you being another way on Sunday. This is the very thing that turns people away from the church. We say we love the Lord, but yet we're so amazingly judgmental. That hypocrisy is exactly what people who are far from God want nothing to do. That's the reason they want nothing to do with this person named Jesus, because it doesn't add up. And so we've got to be careful here. This discrepancy between our outer appearance and our inner reality, it's a real deal. And it's something that we've got to wrestle with on a daily basis, don't we? We wrestle with this thing. So tonight, let's just talk about it. Let's just throw it out there, cards face up. Here's hypocrisy. It comes in two forms, two categories. Number one, hypocrisy comes from the person who knows what they're doing. Okay? An actor that is posing as righteous in order to consciously hide his or her godlessness. It's this person who knows what they're doing. They're posing. They're a bunch of posers. They realize that they want to pose as righteous in order to cover up their inner godlessness that's there. And then there's the second. The second form is this person who is self-deceived. This is the person, which is scary here, that what they think of themselves is different than what God thinks of them. And oftentimes, the people that are surrounding them are more aware of the hypocrisy than the person is themselves. Guys, this is a scary one. These are folks, if they are well-meaning and they are really trying to do the very thing, that they think in their mind, they are doing the deal. And they are living this righteous life, and they are doing good, and they are all this kind of thing. But the reality is, their motivation, it couldn't be further from the motion, or the motivation and the mission of who Jesus is. And everybody around them sees what's going on. And they see the religion in them. But they can't see the religion themselves. And they got this system in place. And it's a dangerous spot. So we got this two forms of hypocrisy that are here. The person who knows what's going on and the person who doesn't realize what's happening. In either case, the problem is that life has become a show. And Jesus is pointing this out here. He tells us that if the goal has become to win the admiration of others, it's easily done. Guys and gals, do you realize how easy it is to grow a big church? It is easy. It is so easy. I remember conversations with Rim. We've had multiple conversations. It is so easy to draw 100 teenagers on a Tuesday night. There's nothing to it. It's a cakewalk. There is nothing to drawing 200 students to a student ministry. There is nothing to building a church to 500 to 1,000 people like that. It's easy. All you do is get all the bells and whistles, make sure you got all the right things, and you're telling people what needs to be heard, what they're wanting to hear, and you make sure that the show is in place. And as long as the show is in place, and everything is cool and hip, and you make sure you got the right looking people, and you make sure that you got the right people in attendance, and you make sure that there's this social culture that everybody feels like they're a part of this social culture that's bigger than them, that is better than them, and therefore they can brag to their friends about how amazing and awesome and beautiful and awesome their church is. It's easy. So if you want to win the admiration of other people, this is a cakewalk. There's nothing to it. Believe me, I've been there. I've put the show on. There is nothing to getting a whole slew of people together. The problem is, whenever the goal is to win the admiration of others so that we feel better about ourselves, in that instant, it cancels out any hope of reward from the Father. Now, this is a real deal. You realize how many people there are living on this planet, living a life, that they believe that this system that they're a part of is totally holy. It's totally amazing. And they're bragging every day about their church, or they're bragging every day about their serve, or they're bragging every day about how they've served in the homeless community, or they're bragging every day about these things, or they feel really good about themselves. The problem is the deceiver has deceived, in which that person is getting their reward in full right then and there. And guys, we're told to long for heaven. We're told to live this life that we're longing for heaven and this fulfillment and this fullness of life that is to come at that moment. The thing that we have to do here is we have to look at Jesus' words and see him as he helps out his imperfect followers. Here's what he says in Matthew chapter 6, verses 2 through 8. He says, "When you give to the needy, do not announce it with trumpets, as the hypocrites do in the synagogues and on the streets to be honored by others. Truly I tell you, they've received their reward in full. But when you give to the needy, do not let your left hand know what your right hand is doing, so that your giving may be in secret. Then your Father, who sees what is done in secret, will reward you. And when you pray, do not be like the hypocrites, for they love to pray standing in the synagogues, to standing on the street corners, to be seen by others. Truly I tell you, they've received their reward in full. But when you pray, go into your room, close the door, and pray to your Father who is unseen. Then your Father who sees what is done in secret will reward you." He moves into fasting, and he says, "When you fast, do not look somber as the hypocrites do, for they disfigure their faces to show others that they are fasting." They are so holy. They are fasting. You should feel sorry for them. They're not getting to eat food for one day. "Truly I tell you, they have received their reward in full. But when you fast, put oil on your head, wash your face, so that it will not be obvious to others that you're fasting, but only to your Father who is unseen, and your Father who sees what is done in secret will reward you." You guys see a theme? You see the theme that Jesus is getting at here? See, there's this theme that if a person is tempted to give, to pray, or to fast in order to show off, Jesus says, do it in secret. Don't let anybody know about it. You know, I remember the very first time that I had somebody come to me and ask me to take a gift and place it on the doorstep of a person's house because they didn't want the person to know that the gift was from them. I'm thinking, okay. And now in my mind, this is years and years ago, in my mind I'm thinking, why do they want me to do that? That doesn't make any sense to me. Just go give them a gift. And I find myself driving to this person's house. I'm like, okay, that's cool. You know, I'm driving to this person's house, and then I get to their house, and it dawns on me. What if they're home, and they think this gift is from me? Like, if they see me pull up, and I leave this on their doorstep, and then I drive away, what if they think it's from me? Well, fortunately, the person wasn't home at the time, and I was able to leave the gift on the doorstep, and then I was able to drive away. And as I'm driving away, I'm beginning to think, and of course, fast forward to years later, knowing the person who asked me to do that, I know this is a person who struggles with vanity. I know it's a person who struggles with the outside looking prim and proper, with the outside being something that longs for the attention from other people, and I get it. The temptation is there for them to glorify themselves, rather than for God to receive the glory because he had instructed them to give. He had instructed them to care for this family in a unique way. But if the credit would have been given to them, then the reward would have been received in full in that moment. This was a life-changing moment for me. And a beautiful aha moment of, life. And this doing good, this living life following Jesus is not about me looking good. It's not about them looking good. And if that temptation is there, then we've got to punt. And we've got to work hard to where we're crucifying ourselves. We're dying to self every day so that God's name will be made great. Many of you have been recipients of things like that before. Many of you, my guess is that you've been a part of stuff like that before. As a pastor, I get to do these kind of things all the time. It's super fun. It's wonderful because there's many folks who come by and say, hey, I really want this to go here, and I don't want them to know who this is. And I get the privilege of going over and, you know, and giving this gift and saying, man, I wish I could tell you who this is from, but my goodness, it's from God the Father. And it's just a blessing, and it's really cool. It's neat. You know, naturally, whenever I'm delivering a message like this, God's going to give me a very first-hand up close and personal reality of my flaws. And this is hard. The reality is in our world, did you realize that one of the top 10 relational needs for every single person on this planet is acknowledgement? To be acknowledged by other people? It's one of the top 10 relational needs. But yet God is sitting here through Jesus saying, if you're tempted to give, pray, or fast in order to be noticed by other people, to be acknowledged by other people, do it in secret. How in the world are our needs supposed to be met by people that we need acknowledgement from, but we're not able to live a life to where we can receive that acknowledgement from people? How does this work? And these needs have gone unmet for people for years and years and years, even though they may be trying everything they can for people to notice that they're living this life that loves Jesus, and they're needing somebody to say, great job. You are knocking it out of the park. Man, we got an issue here, don't we? Just last night, I threw this big old hissy fit with my family. You know, this weekend, we were in Dallas, and I got the privilege of doing a wedding in Dallas. And while we're there, you know, we go up on Friday, and there's it's kind of neat. My sister lives in Dallas, and so we're able to see her and the cousins and all that kind of good stuff. And my goal for the weekend is, well, I wanted to say yes as much as I could to my kids. I say no a lot. You know what I'm saying? And I wanted to say yes as much as possible. So, man, I did. I mean, we're saying yes to sugar. We're saying yes to swimming. We're saying yes to all these things, like just yes, yes, yes. And, man, I'm saying yes because, you know, I said yes to sleeping on the freaking hide of bed, people. You know what I mean? In the hotel room. The kids are all the kids, and my bride are on the queen-size beds in the hotel room, and Sam and I are on the hide of bed. Sam and I are on the hide of bed. Which he's a big old wiggle worm while he sleeps, you know? And we're on the hide of bed together. I said yes to that. You know, I'm thinking, man, I'm going to pay for this in the morning. I had no idea I was going to go. So I'm saying yes as much as I possibly can. And then we get to the day of, and even down to, we stayed as long as we possibly could with my sister's house so that the kids could play with the cousins as long as possible, because I knew I was going to be the party pooper as soon as I said it's time to go. And just as long as we possibly can, so which completely compromised, if you really want to get down to it, completely compromised my mental sanity stepping into doing this wedding. Am I one of those guys that really needs a little ramp up? You know, I need to be able to think in and clear the mechanism and pray through things, and then okay, I'm ready to rock and roll. But we say as late as possible so that denying self for my family. Well, kind of the camel that broke the straw that broke the camel's back. Last night, it's about time for us to go. And as it's time for us to go, first of all, Sam's running around. He stumps his toe and rips the end off of his toe, you know. And so I need to talk to a couple of people, but at the same time, I need to take care of my son, right? So I'm going to say yes to my son rather than handling things socially. And so I'm going to go in and comfort and care and all that kind of stuff. Terrible timing, but naturally it's going to happen that way, right? You guys have been there before. And then on top of that, then it's time for us to go. And I see this look on my girl's face. And I'm like what is going on? And as I see this look on my girl's face, or my girl's faces, they say, Daddy, we didn't get to meet the bride. And in my mind, I'm thinking, you didn't get to meet the bride. Okay. But Rachel later explained to me, and she helped me understand it. Then that bride is like Cinderella walking down the aisle, man. I mean, she's there in this unbelievable dress, and she's, I mean, this is like the moment, this is this moment that girls think about, apparently. You know, and this is this unbelievable moment, and man, I snapped. And I start talking to Rachel about all the things I had done for my family over the weekend, all the ways I had laid my life down, and man, I was convincing. I have never been more good at an argument than I was last night. It was like succinct. It was point by point by point by point. Take the intro, pull it back to the conclusion, seal it all together. Boom! It was awesome. I mean, I was like the master convincer that I was amazing. just in case you were wondering, I mean, I've never looked better than I looked last night in my own head. I mean, it's just, I was a rock star this past weekend. And man, I'm telling my bride this story, and boom, I'm just laying it out there, and she was awesome. She was seeing what I said, and then she even ends up apologizing to me for me being me, apparently. You know what I mean? The things that happen. It's not until this morning. We make it through the argument. She beats me and cares for me and gives me what I need to know. So we go to bed. We're not angry at each other or anything like that. We go to bed and then wake up this morning and I'm studying and I'm getting ready again. Just kind of asking God, what else do you want me to say this evening? Bam. Danny, I want you to tell the church that you needed approval from your kids and from your family more than you needed approval from me last night. You wanted instantaneous gratification and told how amazing you are as a father. From your family, more than you needed it from me. Man, like a ton of stinking bricks, folks. I know I'm not alone in this. We've all thrown our own hissy fits. We've all been there, we've all done that. I know. This is why I share the story. Because this is a real thing. We want people to like us. We want people to think we're amazing. We want people to sing our praises, and we want people to tell us we're awesome. We want to believe that people are in our corner. We want to believe all of these things. The danger is when we want that more than we want God and His approval. When we want people more than we want God, because we can see and touch and hear people audibly like right now. This is a serious thing. It's a real deal. Guys, you know the question I get asked more than any other question whenever I go places and people want to know about legacy? You know the question I get asked more than any others? How many people do you have in your church, Danny? That's the number one question I get asked. How many people? How is everything going? Well, how many people do you have in your church, Danny? Well, guys, you know, I mean, that just makes me want to throw up every time I hear the words your church. Every single time. It's not my church. Number one. And number two, it makes me sick to my stomach to think about numbers being the most important thing in a church. But man, this is the world we live in, isn't it? This is the world that we live in. There's a major temptation in that moment. You realize that, right? There's a major temptation that takes place in that moment because when you're sitting there talking about how large Legacy Church is, do you typically round up or do you round down? I'm just curious. What do you normally do when you're bragging on your amazing church? Well, typically we round up, don't we? I mean, come on. We round up and heck, you know what? As today, you can now say we are multi-site. I mean, right? I mean, Thrall voted this morning that they're coming under the Legacy Church Ministries umbrella, and so we have not only a Round Rock campus, we also have a Thrall campus. We're multi-site. Now, this actually is a really cool thing, by the way, but when we brag about it like that, and it's like, look at how cool and amazing we are, we couldn't have created this, could we? God's the one building His church. Man, it's amazing. The temptation, the struggle is real. This is the real deal. We need human applause. It doesn't matter who you are. You want people to think you're good looking. You want people to tell you you're pretty. You want people, all this kind of stuff. We all want these things. The need for human applause is real no matter who you are. And so right in the middle of this whole thing where Jesus is talking about prayer and fasting and giving and all these things, right in the smack dab middle, he kind of takes a right turn. And right in the middle, he inserts the focal point of this whole message that he's preaching. He says these words, verse 7. When you pray, do not keep babbling like the pagans, for they think they will be heard because of their many words. Do not be like them, for your Father knows what you need before you ask Him. Do not be like them, for your Father knows what you need. Oh, I said it twice. Verse 9. This then is how you should pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread and forgive us our debts As we also have forgiven our debtors, and lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. He says to the people, he says, for if you forgive other people when they sin against you, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if you do not forgive others their sins, your Father will not forgive your sins. This is right in the middle of it, guys. Right in the middle of all this, making sure you're polished on the outside, no matter what's going on the inside talk. He says these words here. Those of you who've been praying for a long time, have you noticed something? Have you noticed that the longer and longer you practice this beautiful art of communicating with God the Father, have you noticed the shorter and shorter your prayers tend to come? Have you noticed this? In your personal quiet time, when you're spending time with the Lord, you're reading through Scripture, and you spend that moment right afterwards praying, have you noticed how, when it comes to just kind of that personal moment, have you noticed how the time of your prayer may be waning a little bit? It may be getting shorter. Now, the frequency of your prayer throughout the day is probably increasing, is my guess. But it's amazing to me how perhaps maybe the length of our prayers is beginning to get shorter and shorter. This is my experience. I'm saying I wonder, and I genuinely do wonder if this is your experience as well. This has been my experience, is that it seems to get shorter and shorter because I'm learning that God knows it all, He sees it all, and He longs for me to give all of it to Him. And so I find myself kind of praying this prayer. God, you do what you do. You ever been there before? I have no idea what to say right now because I'm done playing Jesus. I'm done trying to figure out the best situation on this side because it never plays out the way I think is best. I'm done beating my head against the wall thinking that I know what you know. I'm done thinking that I got this thing figured out. And so I find myself kind of, okay, God, you're going to have to do this because I don't want to mess it up anymore. God, you do what you do. You know the situation. You know everything through and through. You do what you do. And this is where my prayer life is kind of, and this is where I am right now. And it's a very interesting place to be. I'm learning. I'm a control freak. I know you know that about me. And I'm learning to not be. I'm learning that that's a really, really hard way of living life. Now, one thing that Jesus is not doing here, okay? One thing Jesus is not doing here, he's not condemning long prayers. Please don't hear me say that. Jesus is not condemning long prayers because remember, Jesus spent all night long praying on a mountaintop, okay? All right, spent all night praying to God the Father. So it's not like it's, you know, a bad thing for long prayer time with God. Please don't think that. But what Jesus is doing here is he's actually helping his first century audience hear something that's very important for them to hear. Because there were pagans at the time that were praying to all of these different gods. It was very popular for people publicly to go out and pray. And what they would do is they weren't quite sure which name that particular god was hoping for in that particular moment so that they would be able to particularly ask the question. And so what they would do is they would just start like hitting the whole spectrum of possible name choices and possible name constructions. And so they would go this name and then this name and then this name and then this name. And they would do all of these different prayers. And what ended up happening is this began, of course, right, to make its way into the church. It began to make its way that way. And so Jesus is saying, hey, please don't keep on babbling like the pagans do. Because when you speak, your Father in heaven wants to hear what you have to say. You don't have to have the right name selection. You don't have to have everything perfect. You don't have to say the right things. You don't have to pray the right way. You don't have to do these things because your Father is always listening to you and longs to hear your voice. And this is what Jesus is saying. He's saying, folks, we're trying to get it all right. Just talk. Just tell God what's going on. And then he does give a construction here that's really intriguing to me. Jesus tells the people, he says, it's time to make six petitions. All right? He gives these six requests in this prayer, three of which are concerning God and three of which are concerning ourselves. All right? So the first three are this. So he's asking God the Father to act. Here it is. So he's saying, thy name be made holy. He's saying, our Father who art in heaven, right? He's saying, thy name be made holy. We long, God, for you to be set apart. For you to genuinely be God and for us to be us. You be God. And then he says, we're longing for your kingdom, God, your economy, the way that money works in your world, the way that relationships work in heaven, the way that, all things work in heaven. We long for your kingdom to come. So what we're saying is, Lord, we long for you to establish your authority here on earth as your authority is in heaven. And then from there, he's saying, thy will be done. God, your will be done, which means we want God to realize his redemptive purpose here on this earth. We want God to be the Redeemer. Now, you'll notice something in these three things here. These petitions, in asking God to take action, requires human participation, does it not? So it's not just God doing what God does so that we don't have to have a part in this. You're actually saying, because in order for God to be set apart, what do we have to do? He has to be set apart in our lives, does it not? In order for God to be set apart here on this earth, there must be a reflection of that somewhere. In order for God's kingdom to come here and him establish his authority here on this earth, we must give him that authority in our lives. And so he's not going to establish his authority in a way other than who he is, which is love. And so for us to think he's just going to come in and like make us love him or make us follow him, that's not him. That's not God. He's given us free will to choose or to reject him. But in order for his kingdom to come, we have to allow his authority to be established in our lives. And then in order for his will to be done, for him to realize his redemptive purpose here on this earth, we must allow him to be our Redeemer. You see how this works. So we're asking God the Father to act, and there's these three petitions that Jesus is saying. Talk to God. Tell him these things. Understanding that as you're telling him these things, there is a role for you to play in this. It's important for you to see that. God's actions require human response. And when God's actions require human response, this response is this. It's an internal change from being self-motivated to being God-motivated. See, Jesus isn't concerned with self-motivation. He's longed for God's authority, his redemption, his holiness to be evident and clear in our lives. And so therefore, all things in us are motivated by God himself. And so he gives these first three, and then he gets to the last three, which are concerning ourselves. Now, guys and gals, I want you to take note of what he's saying to pray here. Jesus is not saying, you know, like I used to as a small kid, he's not saying it's time to pray for the four-wheeler, Danny, that you really hope for Christmas. Okay? This is not this. This here, Jesus is saying, look at this here. These are minimal requirements that are needed in order to survive physically and spiritually. Now one can sit there and go, but Danny, I thought that God loves to give good gifts. Yes, he does. But for us to understand, God will supply all of your needs according to his riches in Christ Jesus, we've got to pay attention here. We've got to have foundation here. We've got to have foundation in our lives. Because what this does is it gives God the opportunity to meet the needs greater than people can ever expect it to meet. Because when our perspective changes about what our needs actually are, we become much more satisfied on this planet. So number one, he says, give us today our daily bread. Satisfy our hunger. And it's not sitting here saying, give us this year our daily, give us today our yearly bread, right? It's just saying, satisfy our hunger, Lord. Give us today. And then there's this, forgive us of our debt. And when he's saying debt, it's not financial. He's not talking dollars here. I know we typically take things financially. He's not talking that. What he's talking here is the failure to pay God what he is owed, which is our obedience. And when we fail to pay God our obedience, it's called sin. And we have this debt known as sin that we're asking God to forgive us of. And then we're asking God to deliver us from temptation and the evil one, which Jesus is not saying, okay, you guys pray that as the temptation comes, then you'll know how to handle it. That's not what Jesus is teaching us. What Jesus is teaching us here is that Father, will you just deliver us completely to where temptation is not even a thing? Will you just help us not even worry about how close we can get to the line before we sin? Lord, let us not even know where the line is because we're so focused on who you are and we're focused on pleasing you. So this sin temptation thing is not a real deal. See, what's happening here is there's a change and there's a flip of the world in which we live, and it started in about year 32 when Jesus is proclaiming this message. When he's proclaiming this message, he's saying, folks, it is time for you to stop acting like you got it all together. It is time for you to stop trying to say all the right things, trying to do all the right things. It's time for you to stop these things and confess your vulnerability. Confess the fact that you're weak. Confess the fact that you need a Savior. Confess the fact that your spirit may be willing. You're going to try everything you can to do it the way that God longs. But the reality is that your flesh, my flesh, our flesh is weak. And while we long for God to receive all the credit, all the time we wrestle with this, but I want some credit too, God. And God is saying, it's time for us to own this with Him so that He can do something with it. See, the Pharisees, the priests, would always tell the story of David, especially when David is saying in Psalm chapter 26, he says these words, he says, "Prove me, O Lord, and try me. Test my heart and my mind." And what the Pharisees usually would teach this as is they would say things like, David is trying to prove himself to be a man like Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob was. So he's saying, bring on the temptation, Lord. I'm ready to go. I'm ready to handle it. God's like, all right, here's Bathsheba. How'd that work out? The spirit may be willing, but the flesh is weak. And that is what Jesus is trying to help everyone see here. This Lord's Prayer that Jesus is teaching us to teach is saying, God, please don't test me. Please don't test me. Please don't test me. Because I'm going to mess this up. I'm going to get selfish on this. Even though I want to not be, I'm going to mess it up. So Jesus is inserting all of this in order to point out that God is far more concerned with what's going on inside of you than He is on what's going on outside of you. He's far more concerned with your heart. He's far more concerned with your motivation of why you are doing what you are doing on a daily basis than He is what you are actually doing. He's far more concerned. This gives us the ability for salvation, does it not? Guys, here it is. When we look at this prayer life, syncing our lives with God through prayer is the way that we're able to ensure that the inside is motivating the outside of a person's life. And this is it. We want to sync our lives through prayer because this is the way to ensure that the inside is motivating the outside of a person's life. Because we're confessing to God. We are weak. We're struggling. This is hard. I want you to be made great, Lord, but I'm struggling with the fact that I want to be great too. And so, Lord, my flesh is here. It's here, and this is who I am, and I'm done pretending. And I'm going to tell people, and I'm going to tell them, man, I'm so grateful for Jesus because, my goodness, I'm a big old mess. But thank goodness Jesus is saving me every single day of my life. And it is such a beautiful reality. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done. Do you guys see what's happening here? What's happening here is Jesus is helping all of us to see that this is a spiritual battle rather than a physical battle. It's something that's inside of us. And guys, when our righteous actions are done to impress other people, they're not so righteous. And we've got to see this for what it is. And we all know people who long to do good in order to be seen doing good. We know that we can loop ourselves into this, but the thing is this here, and we have to remember this, just like in leadership. If you've ever been to a leadership development class, or you've ever been to anything leadership-wise, if you have to tell people that you're the boss, you're not. If you have to tell people you're a leader, you're not. The same thing is true. If you have to tell people how good you are, you're not. If you have to proclaim all of this stuff so that people will see you the way you long for them to see you, you are deceiving yourself. And you are deceived as a hypocrite. This is a big deal, isn't it? Oh my gosh, Jesus is exposing. Jesus was concerned in the year 32. And here we sit, 2016, Jesus is concerned with the same thing. It's the same thing. You find yourself having to tell other people the stories of how good and all the good you've done, you just received your reward. If we're here on earth in order to please people, then you know what? That's mission accomplished. You can do it. But it's not as good as God longs for you. The thing we have to see is that these temptations are real. And when these temptations come, guys, it's just better for us. Let's just go secret about it. Let's do it in secret. So that God is our audience. He is our goal to please. Here's the cool part about it. The weirdest thing happens. When we are motivated by the inside to please God, you know what ends up happening? Human accolades start showing up. Isn't that weird? When we're motivated by God and His goodness, and His goodness is coming in us and His light is shining through us, everybody on this planet wants good news. And when our lives are a reflection of the good news of Jesus Christ, it is amazing how people long to be drawn to that. But then we have to resist the temptation, that being why we're doing it right. What a difference. Then the challenge becomes not thinking, oh man, I am really good. God the Father and His economy is not the way it works. And so guys, tonight, in order to usher in God's kingdom here on this earth, we got to ask the question. The question that we ask ourselves is, what is motivating us to do the good that I'm doing? What's motivating us to do the good that I'm doing? But I encourage all of us tonight, we're to let our light shine bright before others so that God may be glorified. And we've got to pray against this desire to be glorified as well. Father, I thank you for tonight. And man, what a treat, Lord, it is to get to hear your word and to get to celebrate your ways and to get to see that your kingdom, Lord, is different than our kingdom. Lord, the way that you choose for us to live life is different. And Lord, we consciously and oftentimes, Lord, we get deceived by the deceiver. And Lord, I pray tonight that you will help us. Lord, you will help us to see that you are the reason that we live. You are the one that's motivating life. And Lord, when we do that, Lord, there's satisfaction. And there's honor. There's glory. And there's all of this. But Lord, I pray that the people who then become drawn, they initially think it's us that they're drawn to. Lord, may it be you and your light that they are drawn to. Lord, I pray that you help us tonight. Lord, help us to expose ourselves in this night and say, Lord, we need you. And Lord, we're going to surrender everything to you. We're going to give you our all, and we long for you to be our all in all. But Lord, we will first need our needs met by you, and then in your way, and in the way that only you can do, we know that the tangible needs that we need as humans on this planet will be met as well. Lord, let us not rob you of the privilege of that equation. Lord, I pray that you help us to see the truth. Help us to see the truth. We pray this in the name of Jesus. Amen.